I'm opening the mic.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the CFP National Championship Game Media Day with the Alabama Crimson Tide. In just a few moments, you can use the raise hand function to indicate you want to ask a question, and then we will unmute your line and you will be able to ask a question. First, we're joined by linebacker Will Anderson Jr. Again, if you have a question, raise your hand and we will call on you. Our first question this morning comes from Aaron Suttles. Aaron?
Hey, Will. Aaron Suttles, The Athletic. Can you talk about Alabama's, you guys' strength against the run this year, and you in particular, how unselfish you have to be as an outside linebacker who maybe wants to pressure the passer, but you're pretty good against the run too.
You know, that's one of our goals on our goal sheet is, you know, we're really big on stopping run, you know, how many yards they get per game and holding them to a certain amount of yards. So I think like during fall camp, summertime, you know, spring ball, I think that's where we get a chance where we just work on our technique, making sure that we're shocking and shedding and getting up in blocks the right way. Everybody standing in their gaps, because that's one of the biggest parts of our defense is stopping the run. So, you know, every day in practice, we have to do drills to make sure that, you know, everybody's using their hands, everybody getting up blocks really well. And that's just one of the biggest goals that we have. So, you know, I think we've been doing a really good job this year stopping the run, and we just want to keep carrying that over into this game.
Our next question will come from Rocco DeSangro. Go ahead, Rocco.
Hey, Will. Rocco DeSangro of News 19 in Huntsville. Whether it's this year or last, what is the best piece of advice you've received from Coach Saban that'll stick with you for the rest of your college career?
The best piece of advice I received from Coach Saban will probably just be facing adversity, you know, never giving up, you know, no matter how hard something gets, you know, keep fighting to the end. Don't let it control you. Don't let it get too overwhelming. Don't put too much pressure on yourself. Just go out there, have fun, and, you know, whatever happens, happens.
Okay, our next question will come from Bill Bender. Go ahead, Bill.
Oh, Will, before this Cincinnati game, a lot was made of your comments about being the underdog. Is that the same mentality you take into this game? And how does the Alabama program even maintain that philosophy, given all the success the program's had?
You know, again, you know, Alabama does have a lot of success, but I was speaking generally when I said over the course of the season, but us being underdogs, you know, us not being respected and, you know, people saying that we wasn't an elite team. And I think everybody, that just fuels everybody up because we know how hard we work. We know what type of team we have. And, you know, it's going to be the same to the end of the season, which is, you know, coming up. So we keeping that same intensity, same energy, you know, what everybody was saying about us. We're just going to keep using it as motivation because we know what type of team we are. We know what we put in day out. We know how we prepare and we know how we play.
Our next question will come from Ryan Hennessy. Go ahead, Ryan.
Hey, well, it's been quite a journey to see you turn into one of the leaders on the team this year. Just as a sophomore, you won it all last year. But overall, after this year is all said and done, what is a successful season for you?
What is a successful season for me? A successful season for me is winning a national championship, making sure that we're up on that stage, all my brothers, coaches, family, everybody, we're celebrating all the hard work we put in this whole season. That's what a successful season is to me.
Our next question will come from Dan Toratora. Go ahead, Dan.
Will, just what you can say about Pete Golding as defensive coordinator, just what he's meant to you and how he's really commanded the best out of you in your career at Alabama.
You know, I have so much respect for Coach Pete. He does an outstanding job. I mean, from going to high school, having a good DC, to coming to college, to having a good DC and building that relationship, it's really been good. You know, he has a lot of respect for me. You know, I've learned so much from Coach Pete from my freshman year to this year. I've learned so much more through the defense by him helping me, moving me around some, you know, doing different things and stuff like that. So, I mean, he's done a great job this year. I'm so happy to have him as a coach and blessed. And he does a really good job making sure that, you know, we're all on the same page. You know, we know how to fit things, you know, where somebody's coming down at. So he does a great job of getting everybody lined up, making sure that we're all on the same page.
Our next question will come from Joe Will. Go ahead, Joe.
What's your favorite part about playing alongside Phil Mathis, DJ Dale, and all the other highly talented guys you guys have along that defensive line?
You know, it means everything is so much fun. You know, I have to give those guys a lot of credit because they give me so much energy when I watch them play. Before the game, I swear, I always say to myself, I said, your brother's out there with you. Look at Phil. He right there beside you. Look at DJ. He right there beside you. Look at Dallas. He right there beside you. So we straight no matter what. And that kind of gives me a little bit of confidence too, because I feel like when you have other great players out on the field with you, it kind of gives you a little bit of confidence boost. And I love playing with those guys. They bring so much energy to the defense, especially Phil. I swear Phil rubs off on me. He gives me so much energy on the field. I feel like when he make a play, I make a play. Or when I make a play, he makes a play. Because every time we both make plays, we're right there together. Like, celebrating or something like that. So I'm so happy and blessed to be playing beside some guys like that that are really talented and really good.
Our next question will come from Nick Kelly. Go ahead, Nick.
Hey, Will, having played in the national championship as a freshman, what did you learn most from that experience, or what are you taking into this to maybe do differently than the first time around?
You know, probably paying attention more to the details. I think last year, you know, as a freshman, you really don't have the type of focus or, you know, that you have when you mature a little bit. So probably paying attention to the details, making sure that I'm lined up right, making sure I'm not having any mental errors or anything like that, making sure, you know, I'm getting the call. I think that was one of the biggest things last year, was just getting the call, getting lined up right. So that's the experience I have now, taking into like a new national championship game. And I have that experience under my belt to help me more.
Next question will come from Charlie Potter. Go ahead, Charlie.
Yeah, hey, Will. You've obviously been a leader for this team, but guys like Phil Mathis and Brian Robinson, fifth-year seniors, are going to be playing in their fourth national championship game. Just how much do you look for those guys for advice, and how much have those guys meant to the team this season?
You know, they meant everything to the team. I don't really get a chance to talk to B-Rob like that, but, you know, B-Rob has been outstanding this year. He's been a vocal leader to us. He's been through so much, as well as Phil. They've seen so much. So they've been able to help us along the way. But, you know, all practice long, I've been on field. I'm like, Phil, we got to get you one more before you go, man. Like, I mean, I'm really big on that. Like, when I was in high school and, you know, I was tight one of the other senior D tackles on there, I was like, come on, we got to get you one. So I kind of feel like that's the same feeling here. I was like, all week I've been like, Phil, we got to get you one before you get out here, man. We're going to get you one before you get out of here. So that's just been the type of energy we've been having around the program right now, these last few practices, and making sure that everybody's on the same page so we can get the job done and get these guys out of here the right way.
Next question will come from Justin Felder. Go ahead, Justin.
What's up, Will? I saw that Dutchtown High School said that Monday is going to be Will Anderson Day. Just what kind of support have you been getting from back home? And also, have there been any friends or extended family that say, hey, we're pulling for you, but team-wise, we're rooting for the other guys?
You know, first of all, I just want to start off by saying thank you to the Dutchtown community, Henry County, the whole Henry County, my Dutchtown family. I just want to say thank you so much for all the support and love you guys have shown me over this season, my freshman year. I couldn't ask for a better support system back at home. I'm so honored and blessed for you guys to be making Monday Will Anderson Day back at home for me. I love you guys. Thank you so much. And no, I haven't had anybody say they're rooting for me in Georgia. So I'm glad of that. And I'm very appreciative of that. But again, thank you. And I love you guys so much.
Next question will come from Ivan Mazel. Go ahead, Ivan.
Hi, Will. A couple of the Georgia players we talked to an hour ago talked about how this time they're going to be different mentally than they were in Atlanta. What differences do you expect to see from a team that says it will be mentally sharper this time?
You know, I think, you know, no game is going to be the same. You know, what happened last game is what happened last game. You know, we have to worry about what happens this game. And, you know, I can't really speak on what other teams think they have to do, but I know as far as Alabama, you know, we're just going to take the same preparation and the same way we do things from each game until this game. We're just going to play to the Alabama standard and play Alabama football.
Our next question will come from Fernando Rossetti. Go ahead, Fernando.
Hello, Will. I'm with Graphical Sports. How do you feel your strength and conditioning program will influence you guys' performance for this game against what is probably the best offensive line, the best and biggest offensive line in the nation? And also, could you share a specific experience with your strength and conditioning coaches that you feel has impacted the team to be prepared for that?
You know, I think our strength and conditioning coaches do an outstanding job with us. You know, our last lift we just had, we had a lot of people PR in the weight room. And for it to be towards the end of the season to have those type of numbers with the type of season we had in the SEC, all SEC schedule, and going against top talent and being able to still PR in the weight room, I think that's really big. And it speaks volume of the people who work in there. Coach Blue and Dog Ray, they do an awesome job. And as far as this game goes, you know, we're more than prepared. They prepared us all off season, during the season, to help us make sure our bodies are right. You know, they're never going to let anybody, you know, slip along the way. So the weight room numbers and everything has been outstanding. They've been doing a great job. The team has been doing a great job of lifting and maintaining weight. So, you know, they have us more than prepared for this game. And, you know, like I was saying, they do a great job of making sure that everybody's weight is good. So, yeah.
Thank you, Will. Again, if you have a question, we encourage you to use the raise hand function to indicate you have a question, and then we will take further questions for Will Anderson. We'll go back to Ryan Hennessy. Go ahead, Ryan.
Hey, Will. Obviously, Bryce Young has a lot of success on the field and with the Heisman, and you were a big person to kind of pitch him for that. What's your confidence level with your quarterback going to the biggest game of his career on Monday?
You know, Bryce is a really great person. He's a really great athlete. I look up to Bryce a lot. I tell him all the time, he's an inspiration to the team. The way he works, the way he prepares, the way he can talk to people in, you know, different ways. You know, for Bryce, I'm so excited for him. You know, this is a big game, but, you know, I'm not going to put any pressure on him. I'm not going to sit up here and say he did this. I'm going to let Bryce go out there and play his game and be Bryce Young and help lead the offense like I know he will.
Next, we'll go to Aaron Suttles. Aaron, go ahead.
Well, you guys seem to get really sharp defensively in the red zone, whether it's creating turnovers or just holding them to field goals. What's been the secret to the success there in the red zone?
I think it's the mentality you have to not let anybody score on you. Do not let anybody get into your end zone. I think that's just where it comes from. It's our mentality on defense to not let anybody get into the end zone. So, yeah.
We have time for a couple more. We'll go with Chris Brees. Go ahead, Chris.
Yeah, well, Chris Brees, CBS in Birmingham. I was curious if you have seen the social media phenomenon going on right now with the Karate Kid emoji that Jameson started, and he's kind of promoted it with a photo of himself this week. Have you thought about that at all? Like, there's thousands of fans who've got that in their social media pages right now.
Yeah. I've been scrolling all on Twitter, and that's all I've been seeing. I don't really know too much about it. Like, everybody on the team does it, but it's really like an offensive thing. So, like, we just see them doing it, but we don't know, like, what they have going on with it. But, like, on my TL, that's all I've been seeing. And I think I seen something like Gumpster or something like that. I don't know, like, the backstory of anything about it, but that's all I've been seeing on my TL. I think it's really cool, especially for something you do in a game and the fans, you know, take after it and, you know, they support you behind it. And, you know, it grows on social media like that, and it just goes to the fans and they really love it. And it just shows you how much of a support system we have and a great fan base we have. So we appreciate those guys.
Awesome. Thanks, man.
Okay, we'll now go to Justin Felder. Go ahead, Justin.
Hey, Will. So I heard about a giraffe costume growing up. I heard about, I think it was like mayonnaise and jelly sandwiches. So let me ask you, what was the number one prank either pulled on you or by you growing up?
Okay. You know, enough about what happened to me. I'm going to tell you what I did. So back at my home, one day we had a Sunday dinner after church, whatever like that. And my mom had made cornbread. And instead of making the cornbread in the squares that she used to do on the frying pan, she made it in like the cupcake holders. So we had some left over. And I was telling my sister, I said, hey, I'm finna bake some cupcakes. You know, I'm finna get y'all right. We finna eat good. So the next day I took the corn muffins or you know, cornbread, and I just put I put icing on them because they was already in cupcake form. I put icing on them and I put some sprinkles on them. And I had told my sister, I said, you know, the cupcakes done. Y'all go down there and get y'all some if y'all want to. So all my sisters rushed down the stairs. They rushed down the stairs, and I swear all of them bit into the cornbread, and they spit it out immediately, and they thought it was cupcakes. So that's like one of the best pranks I've did on my sisters to me, because I really got them. But yeah.
Awesome. Thanks.
We'll take a question from Vedant Gupta. Go ahead, Vedant.
Yeah, Will, obviously, this is Vedant from Global Comedia. So you have had a dad who has motivated you and brought out that inner fire that usually doesn't end up great for the other team. How does he spark that inner fire in you in a national championship game?
You know, my dad, he texts me all the time. He screams. Sometimes I can hear him. I can't hear him in the stands sometimes. I used to be able to hear my dad all the time in high school. But, you know, my dad, he doesn't get enough credit, but he's been so phenomenal in my life. He's helped me so much, you know, even though he was at work most of the time, you know, just him calling me on the phone, making sure I'm good, you know, making sure that my headspace in the right. He always say, use your hands and use the speed every game, before every game. That's what he calls and tell me, or he texts me and he let me know. But I love my dad. He supports me so much. He doesn't get enough credit, but he did an outstanding job raising me. And I have to give so much credit to him, because I wouldn't be the man I am right now if it wasn't for him. So, yeah.
Awesome. Good luck.
We'll take one question. Final question from Bennett Durando. Go ahead, Bennett.
Hey, Will. Yeah, you mentioned, you know, just Bryce being a good person and sort of knowing how to talk to people. I was just curious if you have sort of an example or anything that sort of stands out to you from that this season.
You know, we have to peer a lot of guys. You know, sometimes when guys get out of hand or whatever like that, and, you know, it happens on all teams. And, you know, as a leader, you know, you have different type of leaders, and, you know, everybody might not be able to get through to some people as Bryce can or as I can. But, you know, you may not know how to talk to this person. You may not know what to say to this person. But it's like Bryce always knows what to say to a player or a person, you know, no matter what they are, no matter what type of person they are. He knows how to talk to people really well. And I really feel like that's a nice gift to have. You know, he's blessed, most definitely he's favored. And to be able to talk to people of like different kinds, you know, no matter what they're going through, and be able to do that, that's really special.
Thanks. Will, thank you for your time this morning. Good luck on Monday.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
This time we will lower the hands and prepare for Jordan Battle, who will join us here in just a moment.
Oh, wasn't too bad.
Come on. Huh? Come on. I'll let you flip it on. Yeah,
you want it. Boxes in the back.
Yeah. No, yeah, you're welcome to do whatever you need to do.
Can you get a shot up there? Whatever you need.
Just I got one little adjustment here. If you want to go ahead and sit down, we're off camera.
Jordan, everybody thinks they've got mass game until I come out. This is mine from last year.
Oh, no, wait. Oh,
no. Yeah.
Do you want to
sure.
Take this? I don't want to make sure.
Yeah, you see it was on
mass game.
Jordan, can you hear me okay? Okay. All right. We're now ready to continue with Alabama strong safety Jordan Battle. If you have a question, please raise your hand and through the raised hand function, and we will get to your question. We will first start with Nick Kelly. Nick, go ahead.
Hey, Jordan, you guys were able to force Stetson Bennett into a few interceptions in the first matchup. What clicked there? What can you try to replicate in this game to do that again?
Basically, just you know, focusing on staying in our zones, not drifting out of our zones, not breaking too early on the ball, just knowing the right moment to when to break on the ball and staying and trusting what our defensive coach calls.
Our next question will come from Ryan Hennessy. Go ahead, Ryan.
Hey, Jordan, I just asked Will the same question. Just overall, you've been in this game last year. What's a successful season for you guys in your eyes?
Obviously, it's a successful season would be to finish strong in this game and come out with the natty. But just doing all the things we've done this year and keep improving on our game and play to the Bama standard.
Our next question will come from Dan Tortora. Go ahead, Dan.
Jordan, you just talked about the Bama standard. I mean, there's different kind of standards around the country for different teams. Yours is kind of championship or bust. Just what you can say, feeling that weight on your shoulders and what you think about the fact that it's really not a great season in Alabama if you're not in the national championship.
Yeah, that's what you commit to when you're coming out of high school. You know the standard is what it is. It's a national championship minded standard. You know, you have to do whatever it takes to get to this stage. And we know it's going to be hard, but that's what it comes with. We know we have to overcome adversity, and that's what this team has done this year.
Our next question will come from Kevin Brockway. Go ahead, Kevin.
Yeah, Jordan, you know, you're obviously playing in another national championship game, a lot at stake, but, you know, there have been a lot of players that have opted out of lesser bowl games. I'm just curious your thoughts on that from a player perspective, and do you understand guys, particularly with NFL futures, opting out of bowl games?
I don't think that's like anything to judge. That's that player's option to opt out or do what they want. That's on them. If they choose to opt out, that's what they do. they want to opt out and do what they have to do to get ready for the next level. That's on them. That's fully their decision.
Next question will come from Alan Cole. Alan, go ahead.
Hey, I was just wondering about for a rematch and kind of preparing to play the same team you've already played a month ago. How is going into a game week like that different than maybe a normal game week in the regular season where it's just a team you're seeing once and know you're only going to see once? Is there anything different that goes into preparing for the same team?
There's not too much different that you have to prepare for. I mean, you just go into every week the same. We prepare how we need to prepare to beat a team. But that's fully going into a game. That's on us. That's what we do every week is what will determine the outcome of the game. So if we go into the game and we're not on the same page, that's when we give up big plays. And when we are on the same page, that's when we play very good football. So just being on the same page in every play.
Next question will come from Rocco DeSangro. Go ahead, Rocco.
Hey, Jordan, I asked Will the same thing. What is the best piece of advice that Coach Saban has given you over the course of your career that may stick with you throughout the rest of your playing career and the rest of your life?
Just keeping the main thing and not focusing on anything outside of the facility. We play for one another. We can go out on the field and we trust one another to do our 111, and that's a big part of the success at Alabama. Just trusting your brother next to you and playing for the man next to you because you know you're going to give his all for you.
Our next question will come from Aaron Suttles. Go ahead, Aaron.
Jordan. Last year you got called for targeting, and you could see on the Jumbotron there in Miami that the hurt, the pain that was. You wanted to be out there competing with your guys. I wonder if you thought about that, getting another opportunity to play this year. Have you thought about that this week?
Oh yeah, that was the main thing. Getting a chance to play a whole game in the national championship, and I'm grateful and blessed to have the opportunity to play in another national championship, and prayerfully I could play in the whole game this time, this way around, because last year, you know, everybody knows what happened.
Next question will come from Joe Will. Go ahead, Joe.
How has losing Josh Jobe affected the Alabama secondary?
I don't think it affected us a lot, but obviously, you know, Josh Dobe is a great player. He's recovering very well. But the guys behind him, like Kool-Aid McKinstry, we got Kyrie Jackson, they stepped up very well. They've been in the filming room every day. They've been upstairs with Coach Vila, getting right and learning the playbook, and they're coming along very well for us.
All right, our next question will come from Haley Sutton. Haley?
Sorry, there you go. Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Just kind of expanding on that question, last week Coach Saban talked about how impressed he was with those younger guys stepping up. What do you think their mentality is going into their first national championship game on Monday?
Obviously, they're probably full of excitement. They've been in the playbook, and I feel like they're more comfortable than they were when they first got in there. So this would be a great experience for them and a great game for them as well as they keep improving.
Next question will come from Paul Newberry of the Associated Press. Go ahead, Paul.
Hey, I'm just curious, how does Coach Saban, a guy who's 50 years or close to 50 years older than most of the people he's coaching, how is he able to relate to you, to you guys and the players? What is the secret there? That, because it seems like that might be the key to his greatness, is that he can somehow remain relevant to kids that are young enough to be his grandchildren.
Yeah, he just gradually improves with the generations. He's fits in with us very well. He's very comfortable talking to us. He's very comfortable getting on us. And we as this generation, we have to learn to take that. I know in this generation it's a lot of attitude in kids, but somehow when we come to Bama and Coach Saban is talking, everybody is focused, everybody is and focused on what he's saying, and everybody buys into what he's saying.
Thank you.
Our next question will come from Jay Graves. Go ahead, Jay. Jay, go ahead with your question. All right, we'll go to Fernando Rossetti. Fernando?
Hello, Jordan. What would be a story you could share from the weight room that you feel?
You said it would be a story I could share from where? I think he cut out.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. What would be a story you could share from the weight room that you feel has influenced a team the most this season?
Oh yeah, in the weight room we do a lot of competing. I know this summer it was a lot of me, Jaden Auburn Davis and DeMarco Helms, Josh Joe. We were competing in the weight room a lot, just having fun working. And I feel like that put us in a good position this year. And that brought us very far this year in our athletic ability and our physical ability. So I want to thank those guys and the coaches as well for, you know, allowing us to compete in the weight room.
Again, if you have a question, use the raise hand function, and we will try to get to your questions in the time that we have allowed. We'll next go to Mike Rodak. Mike?
Jordan, have you ever seen the jacket that Nick Saban was wearing on the plane last night? And just as a South Florida guy, what was it like walking off that plane and feeling that Indianapolis air?
Yes, his jacket was very cool. I haven't seen Coach Saban style like that, and to see that he has a little swag, it kind of brings joy to my heart. But the feeling walking off that plane was very cool. They had the band playing over there for us. They were jamming. They were doing their thing, and it was a little cold in the atmosphere. You know, I'm a Florida guy, so I don't get too much winter weather. So this is a great feeling.
We're going to try to go back to Jay Graves. Jay, are you there?
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Please.
Yes. Jordan, how do you guys as a defense keep from being overly confident walking into a ball game playing a team that you beat handedly a month ago?
Yeah, that's what comes with it. We know we're going to get every opponent we play as best. So we have to come out with the mentality that we want to get their best, and we have to play to our best ability every play, every down, one play at a time, and not focus on the next play. If you mess up on the play, just correct it on the sideline and come back and get better from it.
Next question will come from Vedant Gupta. Go ahead, Vedant.
Yeah, Jordan, I got an interesting question for you about versatility. So obviously this Alabama defense is versatile, but you are as well with obviously great basketball skills. You know, just last year at the basketball championship game, Mark Vitale won it and then went and played football for the Chiefs. Do you see basketball in your future by any chance, or are you completely focused on football at this point?
I am completely focused on football at this point. Basketball is not a thing I'm going to do ever again. I had that ability to play basketball in high school and middle school and elementary school and all those years, but football is the main focus and only focus. And school, of course.
Appreciate you.
No problem.
Okay, we have time for another question or two. If you have a question, use the raise hand function. All right. Jordan, thank you for your time this morning. Appreciate you spending some time with us. Good luck on Monday night.
Thank you.
We will now lower the hands and prepare. Quarterback Bryce Young will join us shortly.
Bryce, can you hear me okay?
Yeah, this is a good quality camera. Look at y'all.
All right, we're ready with quarterback Bryce Young. Again, if you have a question, use the raise hand function and we will take your question. We'll begin with Charlie Potter. Charlie, go ahead for your question for Bryce.
Yeah, hey, Bryce. Just want to ask you about Ja'Cory Brooks. Just how did you think he kind of stepped up in this last game, and how has he kind of gradually done that over the course of the season?
Yeah, Ja'Cory stepped up tremendously last game. I think he's really, you know, growing into that role of being someone we can depend on down in, down out. You know, someone who obviously at the beginning of the season wasn't getting the reps that he's getting now, but that didn't discourage him at all. He stayed ready. He stayed focused, stayed locked in, and I think that's really showing as of late. Someone, when his name was called, he responded, and that's always been a big thing for us is, you know, having that next man up. So, you know, it's been time for him to step up, and he's been doing a great job of that so far, and I have all the confidence in the world with him to continue to do that.
Our next question comes from Joey Blackwell. Joey, go ahead.
Hey, Bryce. Jordan Davis for Georgia said that he and his teammates have referred to you as the gingerbread man because of your ability to run in the backfield and evade would-be tacklers, and I'm just curious, what are your thoughts on that nickname they've given you?
I mean, you know, I hadn't heard that until now, but I guess to you as a compliment. But you know,
you know, that stuff, you know, you can't control. We know how good that front seven is. You know, we have a ton of respect for them. You know, that box, the entire defense, you know, we understand the challenge at hand. So, you know, there's a respect factor there. So, you know, we have respect. It's just on us to, you know, to prepare during the week to put ourselves in the best position to be successful and then execute when the time is, when the time comes.
Next question will come from Paul Newberry. Go ahead, Paul.
Hey, Bryce. Generally, what is it, the secret to Coach Saban that allows him, a guy who's, you know, almost 50 years or 50 years older than a lot of the guys he's coaching, to be able to relate to them and get them to listen to him and do what he wants? Obviously, it seems like that's would be a big part of his success to stay this good for this long. And do you remember anything just personally when you were being recruited by him? What drew you to not just Alabama and the winning, but, you know, him personally from talking to you?
Yeah, I think it really started with, I think it starts all with the respect that we have for him. Obviously, you know, what he's produced throughout his entire career, what he's meant to, you know, this program, to the state, you know, it really starts with the respect we all have for him. And then also really talks to Coach Saban how he's adapted over the years. You know, the game has changed since he's been coaching. The players, you know, the landscape of college football, the football in general has changed. And for him to, you know, be able to adapt, you know, multiple times throughout his career, you know, that's not easy for guys who have been doing it so long. And for him to have all the success he's had and then still be able to adapt and, you know, kind of change, you know, how he approaches everything. You know, we see that, we recognize that, and that means a lot for us. And for me in recruiting, what really stuck out was how real he was. He never, some coaches can make you promises in recruiting. And, you know, once you really understand it and start to think about it, nothing's promised in recruiting. And, you know, when you start to hear those promises, you know, it starts to become a little bit of a red flag, knowing that, you know, hearing a coach promise you this or that when, you know, you've heard it might not be like that when you get there. Coach Saban was always direct with me. He never promised me anything. He only promised me opportunities to compete. He had told me from the jump in recruiting that this wasn't a place for everyone and exactly the type of player and person that he was looking for and that he knows thrives in this organization. And, you know, that was the person and player that, you know, I strive to be. So he was always honest, always real with me in recruiting. And that's something that really stuck with me and really separated this place from every other place in the country.
Our next question comes from Nick Kelly. Go ahead, Nick.
Hey, Bryce. Obviously, Alabama's had quite a run at quarterback with, you know, Mac, Tua, yourself. Have you heard from those guys at all during, you know, this kind of crazy month you've had? And if so, what's been the message from them?
Yeah, I had heard from, and like you said, there's such a rich quarterback history here. I've heard from, I talked to Mac not too long ago, a couple of days ago, and, you know, him just telling me to keep going to finish, you know, to lock in and all that. It's, you know, just to make sure that we finish everything off right. And, you know, to have to hear from Mac, you know, really on a regular basis, and, you know, just to have that, you know, that respect from the other guys in the past, you know, for me, that means a lot. Coming here, I understood the rich quarterback history. Being able to watch Mac last year, I really got to see what it was like, you know, being right next to him. So, you know, carrying on that legacy and doing what I can to, you know, improve it, that means a lot to me. And I take a lot of pride in that. And, you know, I think everyone, all those quarterbacks understand, you know, being here and what our goal is as a team. So, you know, kind of being able to tap into that and feed into that, knowing that, you know, winning this game is always the goal for us at this program. So, you know, just being able to feed off of that means a lot.
Our next question will come from Ralph Russo. Go ahead, Ralph.
Hey, Bryce. Do you remember the first time you heard from a college coach that basically a scholarship offer that they, hey, we would like you to come play for us, how old you were and what your reaction was at that time?
Yeah, it was in eighth grade. It was the last day of eighth grade. I went out to Texas Tech. I had been like in contact with them, and it was from Coach Cliff Kingsbury. he was the first coach to give me a scholarship offer in Lubbock, Texas, at Texas Tech. So yeah, I mean, it was a huge, you know, it was a huge, you know, it was a huge blessing, you know, being that young and to get a scholarship offer. You know, it was amazing. You know, I was super excited. You know, it wasn't really something that I was, you know, I was expecting, something you hope for and dream about, but for it to kind of be a reality that, you know, obviously you have to maintain during high school and it make sure your grades are good and all that. But it kind of became a reality that, you know, I'll be able to play football at the next level. So kind of getting that confirmation, you know, it was a tremendous blessing.
Next question will come from Mike Rodak. Go ahead, Mike.
Bryce, just what did you think of Nick Saban's jacket coming off the plane last night? And just what was it like for you kind of stepping into that that air in Indianapolis?
Yeah, you know, coach's jacket was fly. You know, coach is always gonna step in something, you know, we haven't seen before as a team. So that's to be expected. But, you know, stepping out in Indy, you know, it really just starts to set in. You know, when the plane lands, you get out, it's obviously a different change of climate, but, you know, you really get that realization of, you know, you're in this new environment. You know, it's, you know why you're here. Everyone understands, you know, everyone understands what we're here for. So, you know, whenever you get that change in setting, you know, it starts to get more and more real about, you know, what we've been working for, you know, knowing that the game's around the corner. So, you know, it was a great experience. It's always fun to play in different environments. But, you know, stepping out is really just that confirmation of, you know, when you get to the setting where you're going to play, you know what time it is. So for us, it was all just, that reassurance and that confirmation to know that, you know, what we're here for, and it's time to lock in for that.
Next question will come from Zachary Powell. Go ahead, Zachary.
Hey, Bryce, thanks for doing this. I have two questions for you here. The first would be, now that, you know, we're just a couple days away here and you finally arrived in Indy, what is the mindset for you and the team right now? And secondly, obviously you played well in the SEC title game. So what are some things you think you'll have to do to be successful a second time against Georgia?
Yeah, I mean, our mindset is just, you know, it's just all about the game. You know, obviously this is what you work for the entire season. You know, this is what our goal has always been. So, you know, we understand that this is a business trip. You know, it's all for all of us. It's all about, you know, it's all about, you know, the game on Monday. So it's a pretty simple mindset. It's not complicated at all. We all know what we're here for, and, you know, it's all about getting better and doing what we have to do to put ourselves in the best position when Monday comes. And, you know, for me, it's just about, you know, doing all I can to execute the game plan, taking what the defense gives. Again, just executing the calls and the reads as they are. I have tremendous faith in everyone around me and the coaching staff. So I don't feel like I have to, you know, do something that's out of character or out of the reads or go off script. It's all about, you know, believing in the game plan, believing in the people around me, which I completely do, and just doing what I've been coached to do and taking what the defense gives.
Our next question will come from Chris Brees. Go ahead, Chris.
Hey, Bryce. So we just talked with Will Anderson a few minutes ago, and I was asking him about, you know, his thoughts on that social media phenomenon going on with that karate emoji. And he claims that he has no idea what any of that's about. Celebration. He says it's an offensive thing. Is he lying, number one? Does he know what it is? And how do you feel about that whole thing spreading like wildfire?
The, like, just the celebrations in the end zone?
He claims he has no idea that that's an offensive thing and doesn't know why you guys do that.
Oh, the celebrations. I mean, I believe him if he says it. You know, that's kind of been our thing throughout the year. You know, those Karate Kid celebrations. So, I mean, I believe him if he said it. I don't think he has a reason to lie. But yeah, I mean, yeah, that's. I mean, I can see it. He's probably, you know, he's probably on the sideline. No, Will, he's on the sideline, fire someone up or locked it when we're out there. So, yeah, if he says it, I believe it.
Our next question will come from Joe Will. Go ahead, Joe.
As a younger player, how would you describe the relationship that you have with your senior running back, Brian Robinson Jr.?
Yeah, me and B-Rob are super close. Lockers right next to each other, so I get to see him. I get to be around him all the time, and, you know, then obviously on the field. But B-Rob is someone I've been cool with since I first got here. Someone who's, you know, from Tuscaloosa, who, you know, has been in the program for a while. And, you know, when I first got here, he was someone who was always super cool with me. Someone who was super welcoming when I was just a freshman. You know, that means a lot to me. You know, for him last year being here as long as he did, he didn't have to, you know, go out of his way to make sure I was good and to look out for me as just a freshman. But he made a priority to do that. And, you know, that's always meant a lot for me, you know, not just in football, but in life for someone to do that. So that's always meant a lot. And then, you know, throughout this year, obviously, you know, we're always on the same page and stuff, you know, on the field, off the field, you know, that's someone I'm super close with. So, you know, it's always great to have someone like B-Rob around. And then it's just an added bonus when it's someone that's at running back that you collaborate with every single play. It makes it so much easier when off the field, everything is cool too. So, you know, it's been great being able to be around B-Rob. It's been huge for me this year, last year. I've been, you know, blessed to have the opportunity to play with him.
We have time for a couple more. We'll begin with Mike Griffith. Go ahead, Mike.
Hey, Bryce. Hey, congratulations on a great season. Want to ask you about Mechie and just the comfort, the security. I mean, it looked like you guys could play catch in the dark on some of those third downs. I mean, how do you adjust mentally to losing a guy like that that's been such a go-to player for you this season?
Yeah, I mean, you know, Mitch isn't someone that you can just replace. You know, losing Mitch was huge for us. That definitely hurt. You know, it's really tough. But you know, as coach is always saying, you know, that's creates opportunity for other people. And you know, we've had people step up in the wake of that. You know, we've had a little bit of time to adjust. And you know, again, people have stepped up. You know, in games. You know, second half. AC championship and in the Cincinnati game, you know, people stepped up and, you know, are going to continue to do that and practice the same thing. So, you know, it's not something you can replace. Someone like Mitch isn't someone you can just, you know, you can just plug someone else in and get the same from. So it definitely hurt. But, you know, at the same time, again, it creates opportunities for others. And I have tremendous confidence in everyone, you know, at the position, just being able to work with them throughout the week, seeing the work they put in. So, you know, it's tough, but again, it as coach says, it's an opportunity for people. It creates opportunity when something like that happens. So, you know, it's just, you know, having the next man up mentality.
Our final question will come from Ivan Mazel. Go ahead, Ivan.
Hi, Bryce. We've talked a lot about a rematch in the media, and I'm just curious, given that you guys try to play to a certain standard regardless of who the opponent is, and given that the stakes are for the national championship, has Coach Saban even brought up this game is different because of rematch? Has he brought that up at all with y'all?
I mean, for us, it's all about, you know, we really what he's talking about and we understand is that, you know, what we've done in the past, you know, it's good to watch the film. It's good to learn from that. But, you know, we don't start with any more points because of anything that's happened with the past. You know, anything in the past is exactly that in the past. You know, you don't get any carryover. So it's going to be a new game and we have to earn, you know, the outcome that we want. So, you know, it's really just been knowing that whatever's happened in the past doesn't entitle you to anything at all. You know, you learn from it, but we have to understand we're playing a completely different game. We have to understand that we have to earn that for 60 minutes. And again, it starts with the preparation. And day by day, putting ourselves in the best position to be successful, you know, when the game starts. But, you know, we understand it's different. We have to earn it. Anything that happened in the past, you learn from it, but it's in the past. So it's on us to work day in and day out and to earn the outcome that we want.
Bryce, we appreciate your time this morning. Good luck on Monday night.
Appreciate you.
Again, we'll transfer to Brian Robinson in just a moment. Again, all hands will be lowered at this time, and we'll resume shortly with running back Brian Robinson.
Hey, Brian, can you hear me? Okay. Brian, can you hear me okay? If
you need it. Yes, sir.
All right. Well,
that, knob, that black knob with the white tip, adjusts the bind
for you. I can hear.
Okay. All right. Great. Thanks for joining us this morning. We'll go ahead and get begin with questions. We're going to start with Scott Rabelais. Go ahead, Scott.
Okay. Can you hear me? Uh-huh. Okay, great. Brian, you guys had some close calls during the regular season, including the LSU game, Auburn, Florida. What has made you guys, which have been dominant in the postseason, these two games, what has been the difference? Why have y'all been so much better in these last two games than you were maybe in some games the regular season?
Well, I think some of those close calls we had during the season, you know, just helped us, you know, just, you know, play to the final second of the game and, you know, just had to battle with a team all the way to the, you know, to the end of the game. And, you know, with those experiences, just going to other games, we have experience, you know, just playing until the last second. So we know, you know, we know we're comfortable with, you know, coming from behind, you know, playing from behind 7 to 10 points and also just, you know, playing a full game and, you know, getting a team's best out of them for 60 minutes. So, you know, that's kind of helped us, you know, go into bigger games and, you know, kind of expect teams to, you know, play us for a whole 60 minutes. And, you know, we just had to prepare to, you know, have to play four games and, you know, we'll get every team's best for the full game.
Okay, our next question will come from Ryan Hennessy. Ryan, go ahead.
Hey, Brian, thanks for your time. Obviously, the lights are really bright for the biggest game of the year right now, but I feel like it's a little bit brighter for you after the game that you had in the semifinals. Do you embrace that pressure after the monster game you have, especially with a defense like this, and it's going to say bring it on to Georgia's defense?
Don't really embrace the pressure, only because, you know, I mean, it's not like it's nothing I've not seen before. I've seen this team. I've seen this defense before. You know, also with these lights shining bright, you know, I also been under these lights before, you know, multiple times. So, you know, I have experience, you know, playing, you know, games like this under these lights and against teams like Georgia. And, you know, with me already, you know, seeing Georgia playing them one time this season, I kind of know what to expect from them. I know what kind of personnel to expect from them. So, it's not, you know, any more pressure than how it was when I played them in the SEC championship game.
Next question will come from Andrea Adelson. Go ahead, Andrea.
Hi, Brian. Thanks for doing this. As one of the handful of players who experienced the national championship game against Georgia a few years back, just wondering what you remember most about that game, aside from 2nd and 26, and whether that experience has helped lead to this moment in terms of knowing the possibilities of what you guys can accomplish.
Well, really, the experience with that game just helped me just understand just, you know, the competition level with, you know, just Alabama and Georgia football. And if you put, you know, Alabama and Georgia football on this big stage, national championship game, you know, usually that's what it'll come down to. It'll come down to two teams, you know, brawling, you know, fighting to the end. And, you know, just with that game, we had to make several adjustments on both sides of the ball, on the offense side of the ball and the defense side of the ball. I think I remember during that game, Najee got a chance to step up and play a big role with some carries in the game as a freshman. And Tua got a chance to come in the second half and lead the team, you know, to a win. So, you know, everything wasn't going perfect for us that day. We still had to make some adjustments on the offensive side of the ball and defense side. And, you know, just being a team, you know, just preparing, you know, for the opportunity, you know, when it came, you know, a lot of guys stepped up when their numbers were called. Tua, you know, threw the ball to Smitty, you know, the
end the game on 2nd and 26, and both of those guys were freshmen who probably didn't play that much that year, or you know, made as many plays that year as they might have wanted to, but those guys won the championship game for it.
Next question will come from Bill Bender. Go ahead, Bill.
Yeah, Brian, there's always questions asked this time of year about how long Alabama's kind of hold over the sport will last. I mean, what is the common thing you've seen year to year from the inside that has made this program so successful?
The main thing I've seen from the inside just over the years is, you know, it don't matter who walks into this building, or, you know, for whatever role, whatever coaching role, or whatever player that walks into that building, you know, is the same type of mindset. You know, everybody comes in there and just grinds day in and day out. You know, coaches come and go. You got players going out to the draft every year, and you got guys who step up every year and play a significant role for this team, probably a much bigger role than they played the year before. But it's one of those places where you know you're going to get better with the people around you and the coaching staff. You know, everybody push each other to get better every year so that, you know, we can have the opportunity to play for, you know, back-to-back SEC championships and go to the playoffs back-to-back years, because we prepare the same way, if not harder, you know, every year.
Our next question will come from Nick Kelly. Go ahead, Nick.
Hey, B-Rob, Coach's jacket that he wore on the plane yesterday, had you guys seen him wear that before? And if that was the first time, how did the team react when you guys saw that?
That was probably my first time seeing Coach wear that jacket. But, you know, we was coming up here to Indianapolis. We knew it was going to be real cold outside. You know, he told us to grab a coat. And, you know, we reacted to it. I mean, that was the coat he grabbed, you know, to keep himself warm for our time being down here.
Our next question will come from Rocco DeSangro. Go ahead, Rocco.
Hey, Brian, you've been in Tuscaloosa for a long, long time, specifically at Alabama. Have you had a chance to look back and reflect at your journey over the years, from a reserve running back to now starting on college football's biggest stage? And what is some advice that Coach Saban or maybe someone else has given you over the years that has really stuck with you throughout this whole process?
Well, just reflecting on my time here, you know, it's been 4 or 5 years. And, you know, just for all the progress that I've made over the years, you know, just really just having Coach Saban to just always be there to motivate me, you know, when things weren't always going my way, you know, just constantly repeating, you know, just be where your feet are and, you know, trust the process. And, you know, it's something that can go through one ear and go out the other when you hear it so much, when somebody says, repeat those lines so much. But it's something that's so important, and something that most people should pick up on, because it can help you, you know, in situations where, you know, you got to trust, you know, trust the situation that you're in, trust the process that it'll lead you to, you know where you want to go.
Our next question will come from Charlie Potter. Go ahead, Charlie.
Yeah, hey, Brian. You've mentioned how this is your fourth national championship game appearance. Just for some of the young guys that are going to be playing in this or on the sideline for this the first time, what's your advice to them getting ready for Monday's game?
I mean, my advice to some of the young guys playing, you know, this is the biggest game of their career, you know, yet. And I don't want those guys to, you know, not be prepared for it. I want those guys to be as prepared as they possibly can for it, because, you know, it's a big stage, you know, two great teams playing against each other. Well, you know, you don't want to be that one player on that team who lets the team down because you weren't prepared enough, or you make mental errors or mistakes on the field that affects your side of the ball. So, you know, my biggest advice to those guys is to, you know, prepare as hard as they possibly can so that they'll be ready for, you know, the opportunity to start or play a lot as a young guy.
Our next question will come from Mike Griffith. Go ahead, Mike.
Hey, Brian, congratulations on a great season. Really appreciate the genuine quality of your answers. Really good interview. You have played with a lot of different great players at Alabama, different quarterbacks. So kind of a two-parter here. One, how would you describe Bryce's mobility as being different than Tua and Jalen? And two, was there a moment when Bryce kind of won you over? A lot of times these guys come in highly ranked, but obviously they have to earn their respect behind closed doors and on the field. So those are my two questions, just comparing his mobility to Tua and Jalen and kind of your Bryce Young moment.
Bryce's, mobility is just different, because obviously, he's a lot smaller than the other guys. And so he can cover himself up real well. He can move around the pocket. He can move out of the pocket. He has speed. He has a powerful arm. He pretty much can do everything, any other quarterback can do, But the thing that just separates him is his fact to, to duck and avoid and shed tacklers because his size and ability to, scramble and, get out of the pocket. And, just with Bryce, this whole year, he's earned respect from not just me, but, everybody on University of Alabama football team just by, everything, just stepping up into his role and, and handling his business, as a professional. And, he's just done that on a high level all year, and beside me, a guy who's a fifth-year senior who's been here around a lot of great players, seeing that from somebody who's, a lot younger than me, just kind of helped me. I kind of saw him on the level of the older guys, and it made me feel good because he felt like, that he was mature and he was ready for his opportunity. He prepared himself for it. And, he left no doubt, every time he went out on the field.
Okay, our next question will come from Jeff Spiegel. Go ahead, Jeff.
Brian, speaking of things that, that Bryce can do everything, the last couple of games where he's made those pitches to you, is that something you guys worked on as far back as off-season workouts, or did the first time that happened in a game or in a practice, did that take you by surprise? And that's just not something you see every Saturday on the football field.
Really, this come from, our quarterback running back chemistry, just the chemistry we've built, just playing beside each other all year, that also comes from me just kind of being in the right place at the right time, and it's just playing football, being instinctive with the ball. When I notice he is in trouble, I try to, make myself present to where we can, kind of make a play to, to fix the situation we're in. And, he has his eyes open. He scans the field, well. So if he ever gets in trouble and I'm anywhere near him, he'll try to find a way to just get me a ball to just gain some positive yardage, out of, what have been a negative yard play. And, they're just being, just playing instinctive football, just, us just out there just playing, just when everything don't go your way, we just sometimes you got to find a way to just, fix the situation. So that's kind of where that comes from.
We have time for one final question. We'll go to Melinda Adams. Melinda. All right, Melinda, go ahead and unmute your line if you have a question. All right, we will go to Haley Sutton for the final question. Haley, go ahead.
Hey, Brian, with this being your senior year, capping it off with another national championship appearance, I guess what's your mentality been like going into this final game for you and your career?
My mentality is just, I want to lay it all on the line for my team, for my school. With this being my last time suiting up for Alabama, I just want to leave no doubt that, this university is truly in my heart, and I love it. and I'll do anything to just, you know, see us come out on top, you know, one more last time before I had to leave.
Brian, thank you for your time this morning. Good luck on Monday night.
Thank you.
That concludes the Alabama Media Day. We want to thank all the media for joining us, and look forward to seeing you here at Lucas Oil Stadium on Monday night. Have a good day.